Thanks, David. This film festival wouldn't be possible without David Fitzgerald, so let's have a round of applause for David.
Hey, Dave!
So I can tell you that I can't see any of anything, so just call it out, I guess. Okay, I see,
right there,
I see
front.
There, yeah.
Two questions.
Sure.
First, did you have anything to do with the hidden cameras?
Of course.
And the second is, do you have an update? When did you finish production, and do you have an update since then?
Sure. I finished production in 2007, and they did not win in civil court. They did not get the church. I think, you know, Tanya has struggled a lot in Montana, but she's still there. Her daughter Paris has been trying to get in touch with me. She's now 15, and I have to reconnect with her. But they're fine. They didn't join that other cult. And Joaquin's family is doing great. They're in Big Sur. They came down and stayed with me, I think last year it was Oscar weekend, and I took her to some Oscar parties, which was funny. She's great. They're doing fantastic. Let's see who else. Karen's great. She's raising horses. They all moved away. That was, I think, really important. It was interesting because they all went back thinking that they were going to make their lives there, but it was too painful to be in the vicinity of the church. I don't know what Raymond Mills is up to right now, but there's 5,000 others or more like him out there. So.
Hey, can we remind people that the movie's available on streaming?
Oh, yeah. So the movie is now available, if you'd like people to see it, on joinusthemovie.com. It's available to stream and to download. And you can also buy copies of the DVD there. And you can buy posters and whatever. So joinusthemovie.com or our company, interloperfilms.com, will link you to it as well.
Quinn, you've got a question right here.
I do. One of the things that's really concerning to me is my understanding that a lot of these cult deprogramming programs have been taken over by Scientology through lawsuits.
That's true.
And there are very few deprogramming programs left in the country. Thanks to Scientology.
That's true.
So,
to repeat the question, of this woman is concerned that a lot of the deprogramming institutions have been taken over by Scientology. And one thing that's really incredible about Scientology is, first of all, they didn't sue me, which is, thank you, Scientology, for that. Everybody's like, you can't put that sign in there, and I just did anyway. But yeah, they actually sued C.A.N., the Cult Action Network, and put them out of business. And then they took it over, kept the name the same, and when people come out of cults and they call, the first thing that comes up on Google is the Cult Action Network, they call for help, and they say, sure, we'll help you, with Scientologists answering the phone. Yeah, it's really nasty. And most cult exit counselors, like Rick Ross, I think he's still operating, and there's a couple more, but there used to be a lot, and they've all been put out of business by lawsuits, continuous lawsuits from Scientology. So it's a real shame.
What's the case? It seemed to me that Wellspring was being run by Christians. To me, that's just maybe a more extreme cult moving to a less extreme cult.
I missed the beginning of what you said.
Wellspring, was that being run by Christians?
Wellspring was run by Christians, but there was no Christian ideology in there. And what was helpful, I was suspicious of that myself, not being a Christian, but what's interesting is the only thing that you can sort of tell as Christian about it is that the staff actually meets on Wednesdays and they do a prayer before their meeting. There is no, in anything I observed, there was no Christian doctrine preached at Wellspring at all. What was helpful about it was that because they were Christian, they could understand everything that most of the people coming in there said, because most of the people coming in there had been involved in some kind of church gone wrong that was a Christian church originally. I think Christianity is probably responsible for, or people like Raymond who take the Bible and twist it or take it too far. That's like 80% of cults, because in Christianity, obeying is so much a part of it, and not questioning. There are Jewish cults and yoga-based cults and every kind of cult, and even one-on-one personal relation, cultish relationships. And I went there 1 week. I tried to incorporate this, but I couldn't, just as I did interview Sam Harris. it gave a fantastic interview, but it just couldn't, it didn't work in the movie. But I went there 1 week, and there were all these different groups there. And it was like a model from a Ford modeling agency who was involved in some Oasis church in LA, and she was trying to make her career happen, but every time she pulled up to an audition, you know, if she found anything in the script that had a curse word or anything, she was not allowed by the church to audition for it, and she was just crying and freaking out and had lost all this weight. And so she was there, and then there was this boy there that had been in this really one-on-one abusive relationship with a woman that was also a cultish relationship, and then like two other people from completely non-Christian cults. And they were all there, and they all found that these eight techniques of mind control applied to their group, which I think is what is the core to the fact that there's a 1% recidivism rate there, that they all realize that no matter what it looks like on the outside, it has the same principles going on underneath. So,
as a former cult member myself, I know 30 or 40 people who left the cult I was involved in, and I would say that none of us have ever recovered from the experience. Most are involved in some kind of religious activity that is hazardous in one form or another. I wonder if even the people that become atheists ever recover from these kinds of relationships.
Yes.
I don't know. I mean, I wasn't ever in a cult, so I can't say. I know it's got to be. I found that I personally was most moved by the mothers. I couldn't understand. That's why it was quite interesting and ironic that we were there on Mother's Day. Because these mothers, I mean, I know as a mother myself, I have a 7-year-old son. From the moment you're pregnant, you know, your whole body conspires. It's like all the cells, like mama bear, I'm going to protect this being that I'm creating here. And then for them to have their instincts sort of turned upside down and say, okay, well, if you don't beat your child's not going to get into heaven. You're doing a bad thing if you don't beat your child. By the time they showed up at Wellspring, they didn't trust their own instincts anymore. They didn't even have instincts anymore. So for them to re-engage in that and become mothers again when they walked out of there and say, I think this would be best for my child. You know, that was like so terrifying to all of them. So I can imagine, and I'm sorry to hear that, that it's a really hard thing to recover from.
Because what convinced them all to leave? Did everyone leave the cult? I mean, everyone was involved in that church?
No. Dick, as you saw, was, you know, holding strong, and there were a few other couples. But, I mean, I think one thing that helped was that Joaquin really, you know, broke through and talked to them and made them sort of, you know, the cult of confession is a big one, because if they talk to each other, it immediately gets back to the pastor. So it was that one breakthrough where they really all spoke to each other, and they all had the same questions and they all had the same concerns. And and then they realized. And also, because Joaquin was successful in business, he was able to free them financially, to give them jobs and to pay for them to go to Wellspring. And I think that's a position that most people in cults aren't in, because the cult actually strips you from having your own resources. We are actually making a film now about tech startups. And one of the startups is run by a boy who escaped a cult when he was 19 years old. And his mother is a fantastic character. She got out 10 years ago, but she was in there for 32 years. And they built, you know, they have also a building company, which is kind of ironic, and they built every, you know, huge houses, like for Brad Pitt and others, and she was always very instrumental in that, and would have made hundreds of thousands of dollars had she not been in the cult. But she got out after 32 years and had nothing, no bank account, no benefits, nothing, you know, so it becomes this thing where it's very hard to leave financially. So I think that was what helped these guys from Mountain Rock. And nobody's gone back, as far as I know, to any cult. So most of them are scared of religion now, which is understandable. Here we are at the Atheist Film Festival. Yes.